/SCSS. There's a lot of hype about it. There are tons of articles talking about how amazing it is. And when I first started looking up SAS and SCSS, it was pretty hard to find information, real concrete advice on what to do, where to go, how to set it up, and all that stuff. So hopefully some of the pitfalls that I fell when researching this topic will help you guys as you guys delve deeper into SAS and things like that. So I did want to start out with, by the way, did everybody get like the getting set up and stuff like that? Or?
You get permission arrows on gym.
Permission for on your gym?
Yeah.
Are you doing a sudo gem install?
No, just gem install.
If you want to try doing a sudo gem install SAS, that's probably why it's happening, is that you set permissions on your computer. And it should probably prompt you to type in your administrative password. So hopefully the computer is yours. And that sort of thing. And what's the error? Maybe after the presentation, that's something that we can definitely take a look at and figure out how that's doing it. Okay, so I guess I'll start.
Oh, wait, do you have the repo somewhere?
The repo is right there.
I mean, we would
start. What?
Is it somewhere I can copy paste or just?
Yeah, it's just on this. You can also go to my GitHub profile, as I know you're
following.
So I'm just going to give you a brief snapshot of what SAS and SCSS is. These are very, very basic things. You can find this stuff online anywhere, but I guess it's helpful to have a starting place at some point. So it was designed by Hampton Kaplan and developed by Nathan Weizenbaum and Chris Epstein. You guys can definitely read that, so I don't need to be reading all of these slides all the time. But the reason it was created, so it was created to sort of match HAML. And for those of you that don't know what HAML is, it is a different way of writing ERB, which is a processor for HTML and Ruby on Rails. I'll show you the syntax and stuff like that. So the way that HAML is designed, it was designed for developers to be able to read things succinctly. It got rid of a lot of these tags and things like that that you find in HTML. HTML is pretty hard to read when you make it very, very robust. So HAML was a great way for HTML to be replaced and make it so that it's easy to read. SAS, on the other hand, is the CSS version or answer to writing things a little bit easier. However, that's not where they decided to stay. SAS currently supports two different syntaxes, which makes it totally confusing, and if you're somebody that's just off the streets trying to look at articles, you give up after about three articles because they have everything written in a variety of different ways and they're a variety of different pieces of information. All the information is, for the most part, true. It's just it's very, very hard to decipher between the two. So the two different supported syntax, you have a .sass, and that is written to look more like HAML. And then you have an SCSS, or a .scss, and that's written to look more like the current CSS. So for this presentation, we're going to go over the .scss. And honestly, the way that it looks, SAS is the first language that it was written. And then they decided, okay, let's make a different syntax to match more of the CSS version. So the CSS, or the S.scss version came out afterward. As I was doing a lot of my research, actually, I've noticed a lot of developers really use both. So they're going to use a .sass for styling, and then they're going to use a .scss for logic for all of you back-end developers that use front-end things. You may actually dive into some of this stuff. And then, what the heck is CSS preprocessing, and why do we need it? So SAS can do a lot of things that CSS can't. And I will actually go throughout the presentation and show you these things, but just know now that basically what it's doing is it's doing things that you're writing in one file, and then it's pre-processing it into CSS. you're not actually building anything into an ERB or HTML file that's any different than what you would normally do with a normal CSS file. You're still building a normal CSS file into your HTML. You're just using this file to write all of your code, and what that does is it then compiles all of it and turns it into CSS3. Any questions so far? Awesome. Okay, so these are the two different syntaxes. On the left hand side, you have the SAS syntax, and this is going to match HAML a lot more. As I said before, it really strips out the brackets. It's a lot easier to read. There are just a bunch of things that make it so that it's a lot cleaner, it's faster to write, and it generally has a lot less code in it. So when you're looking at a SAS or a .SAS file, it's pretty easy to read if you sort of know what you're going into. Now, .SCSS syntax on the right looks more like your traditional CSS. One of the things that they've said is that, or developers have said, is that with the brackets, you sort of understand logical problems and blocks a little bit better than if you were without the brackets. So it's a little bit more abstract on the left side. It's easier to write, but if you're looking to take on big logical problems and you want to make that more concrete, maybe go with the SCSS version syntax a little more. All right, so the basics. We're not going to get to all of these because I tend to talk a lot and this is a lot of stuff in here. So I will have resources and things like that that you can go check out on later. But the basics of SAS and what does it offer that maybe CSS doesn't or doesn't in the way that we sort of do in SAS. The nice thing is it offers variables. For any programmer out here, we definitely know what variables are, and that makes it really nice when you're styling things. You can also use logical operators, things like plus, minus, divided, or division, the modulo, or the modulus, things like that, which is kind of nice when you start thinking about CSS as a programmer rather than somebody that's maybe just like in quote front-end developer, which is not something that, which is something I think we need to get away from. You can also nest, which is a huge offender, and most people like doing this, so I'll tell you why. Maybe you should stay away from it. For the most part, you can add mixins, and you can do this in CSS3 as well, but the mixins are a little bit easier to understand and read from a SAS standpoint of view. For all of you object-oriented programmers out there, it does have inheritance. It doesn't have inheritance like you would normally think of inheritance, but it does have it, and as the language starts to grow, it's something that you'll definitely be pretty cool with as time goes on, and you can think about it in a more programmatic way. It does have loops, which is awesome because it'll save you a lot of time writing all that CSS code. You don't have to do it as much. It makes it a lot easier to do. And then finally, functions. SAS has a huge file on all the functions that it builds into its program, but you can also build functions into, or your own functions into SAS as well. We probably won't get to functions today, but I do have some resources after that will hopefully, if you're interested still, you can delve into those and get more information out of them. All right, so for the project, for those of you that have downloaded the project or were able to download it, this is what the file structure looks like in that SCSS folder that you got on the project. So one of the things that I really like to spend a little bit of time talking about is this idea that when you're planning to implement CSS into any of your projects, there needs to be some forethought into it. And I am number one huge offender right here that whenever I see a project, I will plow into it and try to get it done as quickly as possible. But there are a couple drawbacks to this. Number one, I myself, when I go into a project, after 3 months of having not touched it, I have no clue what I did. I wrote all the CSS, I wrote all the code, I should know everything, but my brain can't handle that. I mean, I can hardly remember what I ate for lunch today. So, pre-planning is extremely, extremely important. You definitely want to make sure that you are thinking about how to implement your CSS. The one nice thing about SAS is it comes with two major files that you can use. Has this thing called a manifest file, and it has this thing called partials. So the manifest file is actually the only file in your in this project, but it is the only file in all the projects you work on in general that will actually pre-compile the CSS into an actual CSS file. And if that sounds confusing, it's because I probably said that wrong, or a little bit confusingly, I'll show you how to make a little bit more sense. Now, partials. This is actually a cool thing. So you can actually break up all of your CSS files into various style sheets and things like that. So if you were to do that with normal CSS, the issue becomes is that you are going to have to find some way to compile all that CSS into your system. And having five CSS style sheets compiling all into one system, people will definitely have a problem with that, and your user probably will too if you have, you know, 4,000 lines of CSS code that you're trying to get in there. So partials is something that you can build into a SAS file that basically doesn't render when the compiling is happening. But what it does is it actually pushes all the information into this manifest file. And then that manifest file will take all of these partials and then pre-compile all that CSS in one document. So when you're loading the page, you're actually speeding it up just a little bit more. And it may not notice it today because we're working on a mobile environment and the project file is not super huge, but if you are working on a gigantic project, stuff like this is super, super important. So let's go through the file structure for a little bit. We have our application.scss here. That is the manifest file that we're going to be working with today. The next we have the application.css. Now this is the file that is actually going to get linked into the HTML file. This is where all the CSS will show up in your view side. So that's something to keep in mind. That's very, very important. That you never want to touch the application.css file, but it is there for you to make sure that everything is loading correctly, and actually, in all actuality, physically, it is compiling into an HTML file. And then you have your application.css.map. Now this is the file that actually converts everything from the .scss file into your CSS, so that is a very necessary thing. And if you downloaded the project, you don't see that on there because I intentionally left that out for now. Okay, so now we go into this file structuring. When you're planning CSS, you really, really want to make sure that if you're ever going to do a redesign on a site, you don't ever want to change the content. Content is king, content is always going to be king, but why do you need to rewrite the content over and over and over again if you're going to redesign your site all the time? Which makes SCSS super nice, because what you can do is if you find a way to make it so that you're able to put all of your IDs, all of your classes and everything, you can name them from a general point, a standpoint of view, any developer can actually go in and make changes, redesign the site, and not have to change any of the HTML architecture. All the information is there for you. It can be just presented in various ways. So we'll go through this a little bit. So I've sectioned them out into different folders, and everybody's going to have their opinion on the best way to do this. Now, I did leave one file out, but we'll go through that later. So the first file, or the first directory I put in there was the base. So the base is going to have the resets and then the variables. These are fairly self-explanatory. The resets are going to be all of your, you know, general CSS resets, the things that you need to get in place in order to make sure that you have some sort of working file to make it so that when you go in and actually do the heavy lifting for CSS, like, these things are not going to get in the way. So for example, they're going to basically, in my resets folder, or in this resets file, I have some headers, I've got some paragraphs, and then I have just a little star with a margin and padding set to 0. So that way, when I open the HTML file, everything is ready for me to go to style from scratch. The variables is something that we'll go over, but the variables is kind of cool because that allows me to set all the variables in the style sheet. So if I set this now, any developer can come in and they know exactly where to set the variables, or they know exactly where to make edits and things like that. So it makes it a little bit easier, not only on myself, but on other people. Next, we have the layout. So the grid.scss. The grid is self-explanatory. It's really just putting in all the grid and all the infrastructure into the file itself. Pretty self-explanatory. Next are the modules. So you have buttons, forms, and then I have skill images. Things like that can be separated into their own thing. You could potentially put them into the resets file, but that gets a little bit exhaustive and extensive. The module things are great because the nice thing about these is these are the images, or these are the pieces of code that are generally going to change their state at some points during your application work. So putting them there, the module file is there, so when somebody loads the page, this is what they default to. So that's what the module thing is. So all the buttons, the forms, and the skilled images, when you hit that new page for the first time, it's actually just the default architecture that's there. When you change something, I left that to the state file, so this is the overrides. So it can be anything as basic as hover over buttons when you change the color, to the way forms change if you need to change forms, or the way any of the infrastructure or any of these modules change as time goes on as you're interacting with the application. So when you're thinking about it, if you're working on static sites, okay, this is not going to make a huge difference, but when you're working with dynamic sites, dynamic content, the user is coming in, and different states are changing at different times, you definitely want to make sure that you know you can change the states separate of the buttons or of the modules themselves. So that just gives you a nice breakdown in terms of how things are going. Any questions still? Can I get everybody? Alright, cool. Nobody's falling asleep yet. Alright, cool. This is not what I wanted. Actually, let's go to variables first. So we are now going to do some coding here. And so when I open the file, we're going to make a small little portfolio. Right now, this is the HTML. Nothing to it. I haven't actually linked anything, any super crazy CSS. Actually, there's no CSS in this right now. So as you can see, doesn't look very good. But the cool thing is SCSS and CSS will make things look a lot better. But I will show you that it's easy to switch skins and themes super quickly. So let me just make sure that I'm in the correct folder. And in the terminal here, can you guys see this okay, or do I need to make this a little bigger?
Make it a little bigger, please.
There we go. Let's clear this. So as you can see in the file folder, we have bio.html, the README text that you can in there, and then an IMG folder, which is the images folder, and then we have our SCSS folder. In a normal project, you would probably also have a CSS folder, just didn't get around to it when building these projects. So, shame on me. So what we're going to do, actually, we're going to open up our SCSS folder, and we're going to take a look at what the contents are in here. Again, I showed you the file structure already, but this is what you see from the actual point of view. So we got our application.scss, and this is the thing that we're actually going to play around with right now. So this is assuming that you have Ruby installed. This is also assuming that you have Sass installed as well. But this next piece of code is a little tidbit to get yourself started in a local host environment without actually having to throw up anything on your on another server. We're going to do sass.watch, and then application. CSS. So right now we're just telling Sass to watch for the application.scss file. We're going to make it a colon, and then we are going to create our CSS file right now. So what this is doing is it's saying, okay, watch for the application.scss file. Once we've found it, make any changes to that, we are now going to create this application.css folder for you, or file for you, and it's also going to have a map. So, presto, this is essentially what it looks like now. And if you've worked in Rails and stuff like that, it's the same thing as just sort of doing Rails S at this point. You're starting up the Sass engine, so now it's watching for the CSS application. So we've got this all good and gone. So let's just actually go into our screen. I'm open this in Atom right now. Alright, so this is our HTML. Pretty sweet, you might say. But yeah, just the general HTML that we all saw. So on the left-hand side, we are going to go into our application.scss folder. And I've actually done a lot of the heavy work now for you guys. But this is a good learning tool, so hopefully you can take something away. And if you need a portfolio, this is actually kind of a cool start for it. I do say so myself. So the application.scss file is actually not doing much. It's actually just importing all of the partials into it, into the file itself, so that CSS can process that afterward. So as you can see, SAS, huge on this import function. Very, very easy to create an import. Just type in at import, and then it's just a file structure, essentially in quotes. And I've organized this out just in case anybody else wanted to develop on top of this. They could easily understand, you know, where some of these things are coming from. All right, so let's get into variables. So variables, I already have the variables written out, just because it would take a lot of time and nobody wants to watch me type and any of this stuff. But variables are pretty self-explanatory. You can call them as you would another variable. The syntax is the dollar sign, and then you can name the variable whatever you want, and then put a colon in there, and then you can place a font in there. It takes strings and operators. It functions very much like any other variable that you would put in any other sort of programming language, which is super nice because then what you can do is you can take that variable and you can use it throughout the rest of your partials in all of your style sheets. So right now I've set the primary font, I've set the header fonts, and then I've set the colors. Now the colors is kind of cool because if you don't want to spend a lot of time changing colors throughout your CSS file, you can set the colors here, and then if you need to change them, they will change as time goes on. But it is something to think about when you're trying to architect your application, because you don't always want to be going back into your other partials and changing it. And I did that because I was bulldozing through this project too, and I had that mistake. So clear thinking, clear focus, plan your actions out and ahead of time. It's sort of the lesson of the day. So variables can be a variety of things. Actually, we're just going to write in a tertiary color. I'm going for a black and white theme. And honestly, black and white can be boring sometimes. So the operators, let me show you the operators function. You can set that into a variable as well. But operators work the same way that operators in other programming languages. The cool thing about this is that you can set different shades of your colors. And that's where the operator function works for colors at least. So let's say I have a... So we're starting out with black here. Black, you know, pretty boring color. But let's say we wanted to add 80 to this. We can set it like this. And now what we're going to see is what happens when we're doing the operators. So we're taking the hex value. We're actually adding 80 to each increment, each two numbers. So the way that hex values work is it's broken up into red, blue, and green. Numbers that denote that stuff. So what we're doing is we're actually taking the 80 and we're adding it to the first set of numbers, the second set of numbers, and then the third set of numbers. And so actually you're going to get 80, 80, 80 afterwards when that is all done, or when that's all said and done. Actually, we want to go into right now modules, we want the buttons, because the button actually probably needs a color. So we name the variable tertiary. And if we go into our file, actually we can see now that the SAS is all made up and looks fairly nice now. But what we did now is if we hook over the button, we can see that the grid changed. So using operators can be very, very easy if you need to change shades for colors. And this is big, especially in corporate environments where style guides are all the rage. And when they're looking for ways distinct. They'll actually go and they will look for different shades of that exact same color. And some people go to the point of mathematically doing it, and that, you know, gives developers nightmares sometimes. So, and this is a project I'm definitely, you know, going through myself currently. So yeah, operators, kind of cool. Variables, also kind of cool. Definitely something to get in the know in terms of where you can place these things. Any questions on variables?
So just the way that everything is compiled into the application.css, that's what allows the variables to be global on all the style sheets?
Yeah, so all of the, so yeah, in, and that's a good point. Variables are going to be global in CSS all the time, with two exceptions, in a mixin and in a function. And so for the most part, all of these objects are going to be global unless they're in some sort of mixin function or like a loop of some sort as well. Okay, so we went over variables. The next thing, I guess we can talk about mixins. So for those of you that don't know, I'm really big into Flexbox. I love Flexbox, maybe a little bit too much. and so I like using Flexbox for my projects all the time, which I think it really makes life a lot easier to a certain extent, and until it doesn't. But Flexboxes, I will put display flex and all of these various classes and things like that, and I just repeat this code over and over and over again. Like, I feel like a parrot that's just typing, you know, pecking my Flexbox in, information into these various classes. I don't have to do that as much with SCSS. So if you go into my grid, which is probably where I find most of my Flexboxes, right now we can see that I actually took them out right now. So what I did, instead of having to write display flex, flex flow column, and display flex flow, you know, row in all of these classes, I actually did something called a mixin. Mixins, essentially, what they're doing is they will take in lines of code and you can reduplicate them over and over again. Now, they're similar to functions in the sense that you can pass in arguments into a mixin. And I'm not going to show you that today because it does get a little bit more complicated. Let's just keep it at the basics at this point. But just know that you can pass in arguments into a mixin, and you can change the styling or you can change the status of a specific line of CSS depending on where it is within your files. So essentially, what I did is I wrote out at mixin, and then after the mixin, you can name this whatever you want. Name it a function, is just like a function or a variable. Name it whatever you want, but what you're going to do is you're going to take that little piece of information and then you're going to put it throughout your grid container after that. And then after that, we're going to just basically define all of our information. So here I just define display flex, flex flow row. And as you can see, when we start going down with the CSS, that I included flex column here, and what it did is it added flex columns to the grid. If I do this, you'll see absolutely where it went. So now you can see when I took out the display flex, this is sort of where the information came from. And it's no different than if I were to actually just do display flex here. This restores the CSS back to its original thing. And if we take all of this code out, because this is a lot to retype over and over again, we're just going to type in at mixin flex column semicolon. And we should see no changes. Well, we should, because that would work. We're not going to do at mixin, I apologize. We want to do at include key. Remember that, when you define a mixin anywhere, and you can do this in a separate mixin partial, or you can do it at the top of the CSS. When you define a mixin, when you put it somewhere else, you do have to use the at include first, not the at mixin. So we'll save this, and it goes back to our story, our information. Any any questions?
Yep.
What do you have? Flex tolerance.
Where at?
We've got the previous thing, we've got the flex column. And the container also have a flex column.
That's why you have other developers check your work. Any other questions? Okay. So the other counterpart to mixings is actually inheritance. So inheritance flows and goes very, very similarly to mixins. So whereas mixins, you can define chunks of code, and then you can put that chunks of code in a variety of different places. Inheritance, just like other programming languages and things like that, will actually inherit the class or the object that you're using. So if we think about like this chunk of code here, we can think of that almost as an object for the most part. And so what we can do is we can actually define the inheritance and then inherit this piece of code and then be brought down into another class. So if we were going to do this, we would actually just do app extend, and then this would be dot flex column. Now this is not the best example because I'm not actually using this dot flex column anywhere in my code. But the idea is that you would want to put it somewhere at the top of your style sheet, and then it would go, and you would have parent classes, or you would have child classes and things like that inherit from the parent class. So, give me some credit here. So essentially it did the add extend, and we have a flex column. Is instead of at include, and this is why Google is amazing. I don't actually have to call it here. And then I can extend this class into my container class. So it is going to still take on the properties of flex float and flex column after this. The reason I'm doing that is because I have a flex column mixing elsewhere. This and extend this column. Extend this flex column. Now it should be a rectangle. So, as you can see, everything is still intact, nothing broke. But the nice thing about this is that you can inherit different pieces of class. Now, in just regular, everyday programming, the two mixins and extend shouldn't make a huge difference. That's never going to be a problem. And they aren't going to really deviate from the two of each other. So as long as you know that you can use both, you should be okay for now. And then I do have two more things on the list. How are you guys doing? You guys doing okay? Awesome, cool. Yep. Two more things and I will get out of your hair as I want to be respectful of everybody's time. I did say that I was going to show you about, nesting. Next. Nesting. Well, here, let's go into my slides for a second. Have we all seen this before? Because I will be the first person to admit that I've been like a terrible offender of this. Nesting. When you basically sit there and you try to drill into the exact element that you're trying to change, and you will sit and use lines and lines and lines and lines of code. And then when a senior developer or somebody else comes in and they're like, oh, you could just did this, and you spend 10 to 15 minutes trying to figure out how to nest it, you just want to hit your head on the wall. So let's know that we can do nesting in SCSS very nicely and very easily, but a good rule of thumb is don't do any more than 4 levels, because this is way too ridiculous, and there's no need for this to actually be a part of what you're doing. So I have specifically left place for us to nest. There we go. So these two bits of code. This is how you would normally nest in CSS for the most part. However, we don't really have to do that. We don't have to write middle header div any more than once. So what we can do, actually, is we can take the h3, copy it, get rid of this middle header here, and have it a little bit better, and then indent a little bit, and just write the h3 here. You can nest it within the middle header div, so any other qualities that you want, you can definitely input in here. You can do input paragraphs, you can do buttons, you can do inputs, like anything within an idea or class that you've named should be fair game. Just don't do more than 4 levels. And, so you can see, we have the about title here, and this is what we're going to actually be fixing. If I refresh this page, it shouldn't do anything. Now, given my luck, it will probably break something, but let's see what's going on. And, voila, nothing changed. Which is super nice. So yes, you can nest different variables and things like that, or different pieces of code into the parent ID or class, which makes it really nice and makes your code very, very well organized, and it's a lot easier. You don't have to go chasing for a variety of things. This is, I know that throughout some of the projects that I've done before, chasing after just little pieces of nested code can be very annoying at that time. And then finally, the big kicker. I can't stand them, but I know that they're extremely important and super useful, so I love using them. Control directives, but most people know this as loops. So, loops. You can loop a variety of texts or a variety of CSS lines in order to get the results you want without having to reduplicate your code over and over and over and over again. So, as we can see in this profile, I have some skills over here, but no pictures in which to show the skills. So, if you recall, back in our folder, we have this image folder here. And so I have this image 1, image 2, and image 3.png. Now, think about it this way. When you are using loops, be very, very mindful with how you are organizing your file names. I did this on purpose, image 1, image 2, image 3, because it is going to make a difference when you're building it into a loop. But if you have all these other images and all these other titles all willy-nilly, you do want to make sure that like you will know that they'll probably not work. So have some system to categorize your images. This is not only good for loop coding and things like that, but it's also good for just file structure. If you're working at any company, through in and throughout, people name things differently, and if you're going to search for that file thousands of files later, you're never going to find it again. So, good luck. But yes, so let's go in and create a loop. So I do have a still images thing here, but I don't have any of the code yet. We're going to go through this together, and hopefully nothing breaks. By the way, you can use four different types of control directives or loops in SAS. You can do if, you can do each, you can do while, and then swipe slides. Didn't make it in there. And the final run. Anyway, I won't waste too much of your time for that. But yes, know that you can do four different types of loops. I think for each is the other one that you can do as well. Right now, we're going to create a for loop to get all three of our images to show up. So the syntax for the for loop is just a little bit different, but the concept's very much the same. So we're going to declare the F for loop. We're going to call that. And then we all know our trusty I is going to be our wonderful variable that we'll use. And this is where it differs a little bit from other programming languages. We're actually just going to write this out. 1, 2, 4. Remember that we're going to do 1, 4, even though I have 3 images, because most of the time it just starts off as 0. So we want to make sure that we're also adding on an extra number. Okay, so what I'm going to do is I'm actually going to declare in my HTML code, go down to these images, I'm going to declare this div. Now, this is a huge no-no, so don't ever do this. Don't put images into divs solely as background images. I'm only doing this because I wanted to show you how the loop works. Otherwise, you know, you don't want to do it. It's bad for SEO. You definitely want the alt tags in there. And the crawlers will definitely read the images just a little bit differently than they would div tags. So just remember that what I'm doing with the HTML, not the best example, but it was something that at least I could get the point across in terms of building loops in a fairly easy way. So I have these divs, and they're all built in to individual classes. I'm not going to use IDs on these two, but you never know, you may need to use them in other places too. So they all have numbers on here, so just remember that, keep that in mind when you're building this. So we're going to call the class first. So we're going to do div text scale image. And then what we're going to do is we're going to do dash, because that was the dash. We're going to call up the first iteration of our variable. We're going to call in I for the first time. And then we're actually going to keep going. So just to show you this, we can add in a variety of other things to loop with our images. So we can do background image, and then we can do background, or we can do again height, and then we can do background image, and we can go to DLL. Img underscore, because when we go into our file system, you see that we've named our files like so, image underscore 3. So, image underscore, and then hash symbol to denote this is going to be something that we're putting in there. And then we're okay with this. And then just for fun, let's do background. Repeat, no repeat, because we probably don't want that to repeat multiple times. And then we can do background position center. Center usually works better. Okay, so we have our loop now. Save it. And we save it, and we should actually get an error right now. Or nothing, for the most part. Now, can anybody tell me why you didn't get anything? What's that? Yep, we returned everything in the loop. So the loop is good to go.
Do you not apply the loop to your, the name of your loop to the correct, to what you want to do within your CSS file?
Correct, yeah. So we didn't actually put the partial, or we didn't input the partial into our manifest file. So we go back to application.scss. We can see we don't have the skill images in our modules section here. So we're going to import that file. And then module is just the folder name, slash. And the underscore for partials is a big thing. That's how you're naming your partials file. Any file that you can name it .scss, but you have to have that underscore in there in order to know that it's a partials file. Otherwise, it's just going to read it as a general SCSS file. So just something to know what you're doing when you're building these files out. Scale underscore images dot SCSS, and then we go semicolon, we'll save it, and you will not see something. One of the cool things that we can do. And if we don't see any errors here, we can always do inspect. We can go to console. So, if we're going to bug, let's just give us a little bit. Did we write something wrong here?
You maybe need to delete the .css from the input, since you're not using that .css in your other inputs.
Correct. Then we'll go and we'll just make sure that we have this written out correctly.
You didn't jump that second to last parenthesis at the bottom?
Right here?
No, the very line 7.
What do you mean?
Does that need to be indented?
It's better for looking at it. It is not picking in terms of how that looks.
Did someone say in your manifest file, you don't need that first underscore for your input?
There we go. Well, in order to be respectful of everybody's time, the point is that you can get it to go in and make sure that, like, you can loop images and they can show up. I need to go back and look at that because it works like 2 hours ago, so I wanted to just double check and see what's going on. Anyway, that is all the time that I have. Does anybody have any questions? And finally, here's my contact information if you want to get in touch with me. If I can't figure it out right now, I can send you a solution as to why that loop thing didn't work out. Otherwise, send me an email letting me know one of three things. Any cool insights that you might have learned from the presentation. It always helps for me to just better myself in my presentation skills, so that's definitely helpful. Or anything you didn't like about it as well, please let me know. And then if you need the link to the GitHub repo, I can also send that to you. Or if you have any suggestions for a great tequila beer or what's up?
It's you need to put your dollar sign before your I in your string interpolation.
There we go.
At least it worked on my page.
Yeah. I will also take a look into that because I think it's also just the way that it's being called. Okay. Cool. Okay. Yes. Yeah. And then I will personally send you a list of the resources that I got so you can also do some self-exploration on this. And then if you're interested, I'm also working on a video right now for YouTube just to show you how to get set up with a Rails on a Rails project as well. Because that's where it does its good stuff on there. So with that, thank you so much.